Hello everyone, I'll be presenting a paper on utility of indirect signs of ACL tear in MRI of the knee. A retrospective study on 30 patients with partial or complete ACL tear. I'm Dr. Chakshu Batra, final year PG, SGT Medical College Hospital and Research Institute, Gurugram. The aims and objectives are to determine the sensitivity of secondary signs of ACL tear in both partial and complete ACL tears. Which sign should be used as an adjunct to add confidence to the diagnosis of ACL tear and should be looked for in doubtful cases or in direct non-visualization of ACL due to adjacent edema or error in image acquisition. The study is a retrospective study including 30 patients, 22 with a full thickness ACL tear and 8 with a partial thickness ACL tear. The MRI knee examination of all patients was done using a 1.5 Tesla MRI machine in the Department of Radio Diagnosis at SGT Medical College Hospital, Gurugram. Post-operative cases and patients with any underlying bony fractures or intra-articular infections were excluded from the study. Patients of all ages and both sexes were included in the study. Anterior cruciate ligament is the most commonly injured ligament of the knee. It is intracapsular but extrasynovial. It is composed of two bundles, an anterior medial bundle and a posterior lateral bundle. Attachments are to the inner aspect of lateral femoral condyle and intercondylar eminence of tibia. The primary role of ACL is to provide stability to the knee joint. It resists anterior translocation and internal rotation of tibia over the femur. It also limits hyperextension of the knee. ACL injury is associated with anterolateral instability of the knee joint. By image ACL, the clinical examination depends on the ability to demonstrate anterior tibial motion relative to a fixed femur in tests like latchment test, anterior draw test, and pivot shifts test. However, these tests have very low sensitivity and specificity and are difficult to perform because of pain and guarding sensation in the patient. MRI is the main imaging modality used to visualize ACL injury. It can diagnose ACL sprain, partial tear, complete tear, site of the tear, congruity of fibers, and evaluation of ACL graft reconstruction with the detailed anatomical details of the surrounding structures. The direct signs of ACL tear are discontinuity of the fibers, which can be focal or diffuse, a T2 high signal intensity either intrasubstance or as a surrounding mass, an abnormal contour of the ACL, it could be wavy or making a more than 15 degrees angle to the Blumensack's line. These direct signs are usually sufficient and have both high sensitivity and specificity for accurate diagnosis of ACL tear. However, pitfalls have been identified on direct ACL imaging. A line is drawn along the roof of the intercondylar notch of femur and another line is drawn along the posterior fibers of the ACL. The angle made between these two lines is known as the ACL Blumensack angle. And in an abnormal Blumensack angle, the tip of the triangle is pointed downwards and the angle is more than 15 degrees. Then it is known as an abnormal ACL Blumensack angle, which is an indicator of ACL tear. Some pitfalls in direct ACL imaging are discontinuity with gap formation is not always visible. Locating a tear, grading a tear is sometimes difficult due to adjacent hemorrhage and edema. MR may not give a detailed image of ACL near its insertion site as it is ACL is short, thin and angulated. And most common is the indirect scanning techniques, especially the oblique sagittal images by the radiology technicians. Indirect or secondary signs have immense importance in such cases. The secondary signs which are included in the study are bony contusions, complete tear or a grade 2 signal in the medial meniscus, anterior translation of tibia, uncovered posterior horn of lateral meniscus, hyperintensity in the pericruciate fat pad, a wavy patellar tendon sign, other signs like PCL buckling sign, associated Sigmoid's fracture, associated joint diffusions have also been mentioned. ACL tear is associated with medial collateral ligament injury and medial meniscus tear. This is termed as the unhappy triad of O'Donoghue. Bony contusions are most common in the posterior femoral condyle and the posterior lateral aspect of the intercondylar notch of tibia. Contusions in both these areas are highly specific for ACL tear. Complete tear of ACL is when the signal intensity reaches one of its articular surfaces. This is a grade 2C signal in the posterior horn of medial meniscus, and this is a vertical tear in the anterior horn of medial meniscus. Anterior translation of tibia is the radiological analog of anterior drawer sign. A line is drawn along the most posterior part of the tibia and the most posterior part of the femur. The distance between these two lines, if it is more than 5 mm, the anterior translation of tibia test is said to be positive. As in this case, it is 9.5 mm. Pericruciate fat pad is one of the fat pads located in the intercondylar notch of tibia. It is intimately related to both the cruciate ligaments. A hyperintensity in the pericruciate fat pad is one of the secondary signs of ACL tear, as we can see in the sagittal images. A PD fat sat image shows a hyperintense signal in the pericruciate fat pad, and a PD non-fat sat images shows a signal in the pericruciate fat pad. The posterior horn of lateral meniscus is not attached to the lateral collateral ligament and is inherently more mobile than the posterior horn of the medial meniscus. The uncovered posterior horn of lateral meniscus sign is said to be positive if a tangent line drawn along the posterior margin of the tibia intersects the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus. The wavy patellar sign, if the patellar tendon is wavy, either fully or partially, and shows some intrasubstance signal, especially near the tibial condyle, wavy patellar sign is said to be positive. Normally, the PCL is convex throughout its superior surface. If it becomes concave in its superior surface, then the PCL is said to have buckled. In our study, we included 22 patients with a full thickness tear in which bony contusions were associated with 72.7%, signal in the medial meniscus 45.5%, a wavy patellar sign 40.9%, anterior translation of tibia 45.5%, lateral capsular sign 13.6%, as MRI is not sensitive to depth Segone fracture, uncovered posterior horn of lateral meniscus in 45.5%, pericruciate fat pad intensity in 90.9%, associated joint effusion in 95.5%. Similar, we are the figures in a half thickness tear. Bony contusions were associated in 72. As we can see in these pie charts, the variable amount of the presence of secondary signs in both, as in full thickness, the partial thickness tier also shows the frequency of the associated signs in a variable degree. Hence, we came to the conclusion that secondary signs of ACL tear described in literature were found to have variable sensitivity on MR images. The presence of bony contusions, pericruciate fat pad hyperintensity, and joint effusion were found to have a high sensitivity for both full thickness and partial thickness ACL tears. However, pericruciate fat pad signal and joint effusion are non-specific findings. Therefore, these can be used to suspect an underlying ACL abnormality to facilitate rescanning in a PD fat sat sagittal sequence or as a follow-up scan to rule out any ACL injury if in cases of adjacent edema or hemorrhage. Rest of the indirect signs had moderate sensitivity in both full thickness and partial thickness ACL tears. The presence of these secondary signs increases the confidence of the diagnosis. In almost all cases of ACL tear, these secondary signs are present in different combinations. Hence, together as a whole, they can significantly indicate an underlying ACL tear or even a sprain. However, rarely ACL tear can even present with no indirect signs. Therefore, these secondary signs should be used as an adjunct to direct signs of ACL tear and not alone in diagnosing ACL injury. These are my references. Thank you.